Right, so I want to talk about hierarchical reinforcement learning. So we talked about function approximation a lot, right? So what was one of the reasons that we went in for function approximation? So what are the reasons? You can try to tell me what are the reasons that you went in for function approximation. State space is too large, generalization, then anything else? Right. So essentially we are looking at trying to scale up the solution methods that we have seen so far to solving large problems, right. So without doing function approximation, we really cannot solve very large problems. We will be limited to small state spaces, right, where you can generate sufficient amount of experience and so on and so forth. We wanted to scale up, right. So there is another approach which we can take to scaling up problems, right. So there is another approach we can take to scaling up problems. So that is of trying to find structure in the problem that you can exploit in some way or the other, right. So if you think about what we do with function approximation, that is also trying to find structure in the state space, right. So essentially we are looking at value functions that would be repeated, right. That is what you are looking at, right. That is when you do generalization, that is essentially what it is, right. So multiple states, we want them to have the same value. That essentially means that you expect those values to be close together anyway, right. That is why you are clubbing them together as a single representation, or you are representing a policy, you expect the policy to have some structure, that it will be repeated again and again in the state space, and that is why you are doing some kind of parameterized representation for the policy. So you expect this kind of some structure in the policy space and some structure in the value function representation that you are hoping to exploit when you do function approximation. Right. But we can be a little bit more cleverer about looking for a structure and look for more, I mean some kind of higher order structure. So what do I mean by this? Instead of looking at small, I mean actions repeating over and over again in the state space, right, I could think of sub problems that you solve over and over again when you are solving a much larger problem, right. So for example, think of playing some kind of a game, right. So there might be small moves that you make repeatedly in the process of actually trying to solve the larger game, right. Or the usual example that I give is that of navigation, right. So there are so many problems that you solve again and again when you are trying to solve navigation problems. So for example, suppose I do not know, most of my students are tired of hearing this example, but suppose you want to go to Central Station from here, right. How will you go about doing that? How will you go to Central Station? Give me directions. What is that?
Through which medium of transportation?
To which medium of transportation? Good point.
Is that part of the problem?
It is a good question, right. So I can say that I want to minimize cost. You take a local train. Give me directions. Don't say local train. Why do I know where the local train is? I am an out of towner. Give me directions.
Go to the main gate. Go to the
Okay. And then get into a train there.
Get a train to park town.
Okay.
Get down there, cross the road to.
There you go. So now you actually used a lot of sub problems. So you told me you go to the main gate. Right. So, hey, that is the problem I have to solve. Right. If somehow I had been dropped here from the sky, right, I would not know how to go to the main gate also, right. That is a problem that I have to solve. So very naturally humans tend to break down long horizon solutions into sub problems, right. This is something that we do naturally, almost like it is like, you know, second nature, right. I mean you just do not even think about it, you just say okay, solve this problem, you immediately try to break it down into smaller sub problems and then try to solve the smaller sub problems and then put the solutions together, right. So that is something, a very very natural way that we have of solving very large problems. I mean there are physical limitations as to why humans have to break it down into smaller horizon problems. The humans can't pay attention for, I mean if the horizon is too long, we kind of lose perspective. There's a whole variety of other reasons why humans break it down, but it seems to be a very useful thing to do in terms of solving these kinds of problems as well, right. So this is one aspect of it. One aspect of it is what I call temporal abstraction. So essentially now he told me go to the main gate as a single action, right? But go to the main gate is not a single action, right? It actually has a whole sequence of policies that are going to happen. You said go to the main gate and turn right. There obviously there are not two actions of equal time, right? So go to the main gate is going to take a much longer time than turn right, right? And then go to Kasturiba station, that's going to take much longer time than maybe go to the main gate. I mean, depending on the traffic levels and other things there, right? So what you did when you gave me these kinds of sub problems to solve in order to solve the larger problem is abstract away some notion of time, right? Because you just, okay, here is solve this sub problem, then that sub problem, put everything together, you have a solution. But each of these takes differing amount of time, right? So this is what I mean by temporal abstraction. When I am saying temporal abstraction, it kind of means both, that I am solving sub problems, right, that could take a varying amount of time. So it kind of means both those aspects of it, right? But where is the hierarchy here? What do we mean by hierarchy? This is one level, right? Here is this big problem, go to the central station, and here are these many, many small problems that you have to solve. You put them together and you get this big problem. So that is the hierarchy. But the hierarchy can go however deep you want, right? So let us say, okay, how do I get to the main gate? There you go. So now you broke down into further simpler sub problems, right? So you told me to get down. Now I can ask somebody the question, okay, what does he mean by get down? Right? No, you can't obviously not jump down, right? So, right, so walk to the lift, take the lift down. Luckily we can do that now. So last month you could have just walk downstairs and then walk out of the building and then take a left, take another left, and then you will get to the bus stop, wait for the bus, get into the bus and so on. So now you see that you can actually start breaking these things down into smaller and smaller sub problems. To the effect, then I will finally ask you, okay, how do I walk to the lift? No, you have got to go further down. In fact, you started solving this problem of going to the central station when you are about 1 year old, walking, right? So walking is a learned behavior. For humans, walking is not a natural behavior, right? So it is a learned behavior. So as babies, you learn to walk around when you are about a year or so old, right? So you actually started solving this problem a long time back. You just didn't know it yet. So that's the whole beauty about hierarchy. So you learn solutions, right, that can actually be used over and over again for many other problems. So if I'm leaving at the granularity of catch a train and go to Park Station, maybe I'm becoming very, very particular. But then if you start thinking about the other sub problems I have to solve along the way, get out of this building. That's a problem that you solve every day we have a class. Right, at least every day we have a class, right, and then you decide where you want to go after that. But that's a sub problem that you solve, right? You can actually afford to optimize this sub problem, right? What should I do? When should I catch the lift? The lift is in the first floor. I'm better off walking down the stairs versus the lift is in the second floor. Maybe I should press the button and wait. Right? You can start optimizing to that level of solution for these kinds of hierarchical, reusable problems, right? So if you want to figure out whether you need to go to the Park Station or not, you are probably going to do this once a semester. So you do not really not going to figure out what is the optimal point to wait in the station to get into the train, right? I mean, because you are solving it only once in a while, right? So these are concepts that humans use all the time, right? So when do you optimize for a solution, when you are happy with a single solution, so on and so forth, right? None of this actually, unfortunately, finds a place in the oral literature that to the great extent, you know. So if you want to move reinforcement learning to be a more and more realistic model of how humans make decision making, how humans do decision making, right? So you have to start factoring in all of these things, reusability versus, so it's more like a lifetime value of the policy that you are going to have. So if I'm going to use an action only once, or if I'm going to use a sub problem only once, I really don't want to optimize that. So the effort that I spend in optimizing the solution, I can save and do something else. But if I'm going to use it again and again and again, right, then it's better to optimize that, right? So how much you think humans optimize solutions? Okay. How much do you think humans optimize solutions and who don't have OCD? In general, do you think we optimize solutions?
Yes.
I mean, this is a very bad audience to ask this question in, right? I mean, usually many high achievers have some degree of OCD, right? That's a selection bias. If you are here, so you have some degree of OCD. Okay, so, seven? What, seven steps ahead? That's a different question, right? I'm not even asking about that. So I'm asking about how much you think we optimized stuff. So people who don't know what OCD is, obsessive compulsive disorder. So you feel like doing the same thing again and again, right, until you get it right or keep doing it over and over. Not, sir? You feel like doing something perfectly. That's what you think is OCD, is it? Okay. Compulsive. No, it's not necessarily perfect. You just keep doing it again and again and again. Not necessarily doing it perfectly. Okay. Anyway, so it turns out that humans really, the optimization that we do is not visible to the extent that you would expect from an artificial reinforcement learning agent, mainly because we don't do that number of repetitions, right? So there is this story about the Cuban cigar rollers. You know, so you know people roll cigars, right? So you have tobacco, you have the tobacco leaf or paper or whatever. You put the tobacco in it and then you roll it, right? And then you seal it, you paste it, you seal it, and then tobacco the cigar is ready, right? So Cuba supposedly makes the best cigars in the world, right? So I have no idea about that. But they do make the best cigars in the world apparently. So how long do you think it takes somebody to roll a cigar? Roughly an hour, a minute, half an hour. Close to?
A minute.
Close to a minute.
Yeah, maybe less than
a minute. Okay. So obviously there is something here, right? I'm not telling the story otherwise. So any other guesses? 1 hour. Oh man. Maybe 1 hour, sure, I don't know. We're going for a Guinness record for cigar, make the world's largest cigar or something like that, yeah. So people who have been doing this, it's one of those ugly truths of all these fantastic world's best industries, right? There are humans behind it slaving away. So people who have been doing this for years and years and years, like 20 years, have been rolling cigars for 20 years or so, can do it in less than 7 seconds. Just count yourself, 7 seconds. Take a paper, spread it out, put tobacco on it. Put the right measure, right? I mean, the quality control has to be there. If you are making cigars that don't satisfy the Cuban quality, then they throw it out, right? So 7 seconds. So humans do optimize given sufficient number of trials, right? So but then we don't usually get to do 20 years of cigar rolling, right? So you don't get to see that much of optimization, but you will see that in sports persons, right? So sports people do a lot of optimization, right? So Sachin Tendulkar does like 14 hours of nets a day for 35 years. And then he can play the same shot again and again and again with the exact same precision without a small deviation. That's because he's optimized the stroke to that extent, right? So so we do significant amount of optimization. So going back to the point, so we don't try to optimize things we don't repeat often, right? And quite often we solve problems once. Quite often we solve problems once, and so we don't try to optimize the solutions for that, but then we try to optimize the subcomponent of these problems, right? So that is another thing that gives hierarchical RL really gives us, is this ability to, you know, I'm going to say ability to transfer. So you make these smaller problems, you solve those smaller problems, and then if I give you a completely different problem to solve, right, there might be something from the smaller problems that you solved already that you can reuse, right? And I don't know. So some of these are my thoughts about hierarchical RL, right? So hierarchical reinforcement learning also gives you meaningful modules to optimize. You know, trying to say that, okay, here is this very large problem, I'm going to optimize how I'm going to solve it, doesn't make sense. Quite often there is this huge disconnect between you know, the planning community, right, and AI. There is a very large community that does what they call planning. So the planning problem is, I give you a start position and I give you a goal position, right? And you have to figure out a sequence of operators that you have to apply to get from the start position to the goal position, right? And each operator has a set of preconditions. So you can apply those operator only if the preconditions are satisfied, right? So for example, I can put a phone down here only if the table is empty. Right, that's a precondition. So put something down requires the condition that the table should be empty at the point where I am trying to put it down. Let's say I don't, I'm not stacking up things, but let's say I just want to put it down somewhere. So it has to be empty. So those things like that, right? So I have preconditions, and then I have postconditions, things that hold after the operator has been employed, right? So once I put it down, what is going to happen? The table will no longer be free, because I put something down on the table. So that's a post condition. Now, because some post conditions have become true, some other operators might now become feasible, right? So I go and pick some of those operators, or it could be some operator that was earlier or already was feasible that is still feasible. So I look among all the operators that are feasible, I find another action, and then I do this, right? So quite often people in the planning community are happy to find a solution. Because if you think about the complexity of the problem, it's a really hard problem to solve, because it can be a combinatorial explosion of possible paths that you can take, right? So to figure out even one path that takes you from the start to goal, people are all happy. They say, okay, here I solved the problem. So why do you want to do this again, right? If I want to stack up, I want to clean the table, I want to put all this away in a single pile, right? I've done that once, okay? Why do I want to repeat it again? So it doesn't even make sense to them that you want to repeat things again, right? So if you are talking about a very large problem, maybe repeatability is an issue, and why do you want to learn becomes an issue. You are happy solving things using these kinds of planning operations. If I have an efficient way of searching through this operator space, I could just do it, solve the problem and get away with it. So now the question becomes, why learn at all? Why can't you just do planning and be happy with it, right? So hierarchies gives you one answer for that. So you want to learn the solutions for some of these sub operators because you want to optimize them, so that next time I use this, right, I will be better at it. So for example, put something on the table, right? So put on the table, so maybe the exact sequence I did to build a stack, I might not repeat it, but when I am solving a different planning problem, I still might be picking and putting objects, right? I will still be picking and placing objects. Now if I figure out a way to do this optimally, then that is good, right? But normally in planning community, they assume that the operators themselves are given to you. I mean, they do hierarchical planning, but typically they assume that the operators are given and you can just execute them. But what hierarchical RL says is, no, you have to learn what the operators are, how to go about solving them as well, okay? So I hope I have convinced you that hierarchies are good, right? And they give you a couple of things, transfer/ it gives you temporal abstraction, gives you transfer/ reusability. So what do I mean by that? So what do I mean by state abstraction in the first place? Remember, state abstraction is essentially the fees, right? So when we do function approximation and other things, we talked about using the function fee, right? It allows you to aggregate states together, right? Or operate as an indicator variable of some sorts. We are talking about that, right? So let me go back to the problem of getting to the central station. So you define a solution for, let us say, the problem of getting to the main gate, right? When I want to solve the problem of getting to the main gate, do I care about where I am going to after that? Right, the optimal solution for getting to the main gate really does not depend on where I want to go after that, right? And how did you explain the solution to me to get to the main gate? right? You said get out of this building, right? Getting out of this building, the solution to that, does it depend on where I want to go after that? So it doesn't even matter if I'm going to the main gate or to the velocity. Well, maybe to some extent, but assuming that there is only one way, all of us obey the vehicle rules and go out only through the out gate, right? It really doesn't matter whether I'm going to the Velachery gate or going back to my hostel or whatever, right? It doesn't matter, right? So it's just the same solution. So it turns out that when I start breaking things down into these kinds of sub problems, I can start focusing on things that are only needed for solving the sub problems. Right? This gives me two things. What are the two advantages it gives me? Reduced state space means fewer parameters, right? So I have a simpler problem to solve. Right, in the context of going to central station, right, it might be a very large state space. If you even stop and think about it, right, it will be mind boggling. The state space is mind boggling, right? You have to worry about the state of the vehicles on the road while you walk to this Kasturiba train station. You have to worry about the timetable, you will have to worry about where the platform is there, and I mean whether you can stand here without getting run over by the train. I mean, there are so many things you will have to worry about, right? The state space is so humongous. So if you just think of putting together a vector that represents the entire state space, okay, and then trying to plan how to exit the building in that state space, right, you are going to fail. There is just so many extraneous variables which are not needed, right, and I can't abstract all of them away. Right. I need to know where the vehicles are going on the road when I am walking on the Kasturiba, when I am walking on the Sardar Patel road, right. I can't ignore it. So I need to know where to stand on the platform when the train comes in. So I can't ignore that variable as well, right? But I can ignore them when I am actually solving how to get out of this building, right? I can ignore a whole bunch of variables when I am trying to solve how to get out of this building. So it gives me more meaningful representation, right? In the sense of what is needed at that point to solve a problem. Okay. Anything else it gives me? This kind of more powerful state abstraction. This is what really enables the transfer, right? If I had solved the problem with a vector space that included states that talk about the central station, I cannot reuse the solution for exiting the building to go to the Velachery gate, because I will have central station variables in here, right, which are absolutely irrelevant to this problem. In fact, they do not even exist in this problem domain, right. So I am actually talking about going to the Velachery gate, right. So I can't really take the solution as it is defined in that problem and use it here, but I can use it if the solution is defined only in terms of the state variables with respect to this room or this building, right. So it allows me to have greater reusability. It reduces the state space so that I can do efficient learning. It also allows me to have greater reusability, right. So that is essentially the three things that hierarchies really enable for you, right. And so what we will do this class and the next is look at different hierarchical reinforcement learning frameworks that have been proposed, okay, over the years. And so I am a huge believer in hierarchies, right. So I think from 96 I have been working in hierarchical RL. And so I am a huge believer in hierarchies and how people use hierarchies for problem solving. And there are so many other aspects, so many other 20 years, huh? Oh, wow, okay. There are so many other, no, I'm just a moment of feeling old, that's all. Yeah. There's so many issues that to do with the hierarchies that people really haven't started exploring in depth, in detail. And in fact, I can do a whole semester course on hierarchical RL. There are so many issues that that come up, and there are so many interesting things. So probably next semester in that course, we will spend some amount of time investigating hierarchical RL, other than apart from the other methods that we will be talking about. And let's see. Okay. Good question. How do we split sub problems? maybe that is one criteria you should put in when you are splitting sub problems. Split it so that I can use it for other problems. Who tells you that? It's a hard question. So I don't think I will have time to get to how people actually figure out these hierarchies. There have been some attempts in the literature, not just in the reinforcement learning literature, in the AI literature in general, there have been some work on trying to figure out these kinds of hierarchies, and dissatisfying at best. There are so many issues. I mean, exactly the question that you asked, right? There is no good answer for that. How do we figure out how an option or how a subproblem is reusable, right? There is no good answer for that. Typically, the thing is, oh, the domain expert will tell you, right? Or there is another hypothesis that says that there are points of inflection in the state space, you know, like funnels. For example, the door to this building is a funnel, right? So you could come to any part, and you could come to the NPTEL office, you go to ICSR, you could go to the alumni office, all of these people. Right, enter through the main door. Right, so door is like a funnel. Right, so once I understand that there are these kinds of funnel states, then the subproblem could be, how do I get to that funnel state? How do I get to the door? That could be a solution which could potentially be reusable across multiple domains. Right, but now I told you that this is a funnel state with because of my knowledge about this building. Right, how will you normally discover this? In a hypothetical situation. I mean, geometric navigation problems is always easy, right? If I am having non-geometric problems, then how would you define these kinds of bottlenecks, right? It becomes funnel states or bottlenecks, they are called. It becomes a little tricky. So there have been attempts from try to do this from data and so on and so forth, but there is nothing that says that, okay, here is a very robust method, just throw it at your algorithm, throw it at your problem. For example, I cannot go and define these kinds of hierarchies in Atari. Even though we are trying, there is nothing that will successfully find these kinds of sub problems in Atari games for you to solve, for example, because it is really complex. And even though it has some kind of geometric navigation side to it, but there is a significant amount of dynamics there that makes the things very muddied, right? So,
would it be possible to predict hierarchies by comparing similarity between trajectories for problems?
Sure, how many trajectories?
So, if you are trying to do some kind of a navigational problem from, let's say, outside the building to like multiple points inside the building, solve all these problems separately, mm-hmm. and then try to compare similarities between trajectories and then separate those out.
Yeah, so there are a few issues here, right? If I am already solved multiple problems, so what am I doing in finding these hierarchies after that? I mean, the assumption should be that, okay, I have like a distribution of problems defined on the same state space, I sample a few problems from that, and then I will solve those problems, and then there is still a lot more problems that I have not seen, you know. So I have not gone to every nook and cranny of the ICSR building, so but then I have gone to 15 different places in the ICSR building. From that I will figure out what the options are, right, what the bottlenecks are. So it's fine. I mean, if your situation supports such a setting, then it is great. I mean, that's typically, in fact, that's what would happen also. And if you, as a human, you are trying to optimize navigating into ICSR, so you really need to come to multiple places in this building before you think of optimizing your trajectory through this thing. Or if you come to a single place in the building, right, you are always coming only to the NPTEL classroom, you are not going to find sub problems. You are going to optimize the problem of coming to the NPTEL classroom efficiently, optimally, right? That's all you are going to solve. Right? But if you keep coming here, say you have to go to the alumni office repeatedly, and then you have to come to the NPTEL conference room or the studio for classes, and then you start optimizing, okay, let me see, okay, I will figure out how to get to the staircase efficiently, and then from there I will solve these two problems. Right? So only then you start doing this kinds of sub. It's a little tricky as to how many such sub problems, how many such trajectories you will have to generate. So can you do this by just looking at one trajectory? Or solving one problem instead of solving multiple problems in the domain.
Sir, how about planning, as in while you are planning, mm-hmm. compare similarity to certain set of goals?
See, the whole planning takes it under different context, right? There I am assuming I know the operators, I know the preconditions, I know the postconditions. That is not typically what the RL folks assume, right? So they know, in fact, the planning assumes you know what the goal is, right? RL, you don't even assume what the goal is. right? So people do this kind of sub problem discovery in planning also, right? That's done. So not done means not in the sense of it is solved, and people attempt to solve the problem, and still there are solutions, and there are not too many satisfactory solutions out there. In fact, whatever you said, I mean, there are a couple of papers out there that actually look at that, looking at trajectories and trying to figure out commonalities in the trajectories, and then based on that trying to figure out which are the funnel states, right? So to do this, right? Not scalable, right? It's not clear if what is the trade off between the number of trajectories that you use and the quality of the solutions you get, and right? So of course, all interesting problems. I should probably do this lecture as the first lecture in the RL course, so that people can do RL projects on hierarchical RL. A lot of interesting questions to explore in this space. Anyway.